Hey folks, this is Abel James, and thanks so much for joining us on the Fat Burning Man Show, where we talk about real food and real results. How many hours have you logged in front of a camera in the past year? Zoom fatigue is a real thing, and the expectation to constantly be available for virtual webcam meetings definitely takes its toll on all of us. And you may be surprised to find out that some of the people who spend the most time on camera, even actors and podcasters, actually don't enjoy being filmed at all. Joining us on the show today is the wonderful Melanie Avalon, a professional actress, author of What, When, Wine, and host of two top-rated iTunes podcasts, the Melanie Avalon Biohacking Podcast and the Intermittent Fasting Podcast. This is a really fun conversation, and Melanie has a lot of unique perspective, and she's definitely dabbled in the fringes as far as different dietary approaches go, so lots to learn from this one. But before we get there, here's a review for the Wild Challenge mobile app, brand new from us, that came in on the App Store. Brian gives it 5 out of 5 stars and says, "The closest thing to a coach. This app has me faithfully engaged in my eating like nothing ever has before. Designed around the New York Times bestseller, The Wild Diet, it lets you pick your priorities and keeps you engaged through the challenges. It's complete with shopping lists and recipes. It also helps you track your sleep, water intake, and overall condition. And you can even sync it to a couple of different fitness devices. Plus, the little messages throughout the day really help. Hey, Brian, thank you so much for this feedback. You know, we put a lot of effort, especially Allison, into this new app and getting all these bells and whistles to work. And one of the things we like as well is that texting back and forth feature and the ability for us to just shoot you a quick message every once in a while and have you get back in touch with us for immediate feedback without having to go through social media or through emails even. So we're really proud of the Wild Challenge app. For those of you who aren't aware, you can join from all over the world. We have pre-built meal plans, shopping lists, intermittent fasting trackers, meditation trackers. You can track your sleep, much, much more. And also as coaches, we're able to get in touch with you in a way that we never were before. So look forward to a lot of exciting announcements coming soon. If you'd like to join in on our next Wild Challenge, please go to fatburningman.com/app. That's APP. Those of you who are already using the Wild Challenge app, I know you really like the messaging features back and forth, the done-for-you meal plans, and the ability to track your movement and what you're eating and in a really holistic and robust way. So we're really excited about what we're doing over there. If you would like to join us in the next challenge, don't miss out. We have a lot of fun giveaways coming up. Be sure to go to fatburningman.com/app and use that code WILD25 for 25% off. Can't wait to see you there. All right, on to the show with Melanie Avalon. We're chatting about the benefits of intermittent fasting for longevity, what it's like to be a morning person versus a night person, how to color outside the lines when it comes to diet. This is a fun one. Why Melanie finally ditched the cookie diet. Why some people who are on camera all the time actually don't like it at all. How to gracefully handle negative feedback and online haters, and tons more. Let's go hang out with Melanie. Welcome back, folks. Today we're here with the wonderful Melanie Avalon, an author, actress and host of the Melanie Avalon Biohacking Podcast. Melanie is also a wine specialist who adores a nice steak, a fine wine, and all things that sparkle. Welcome to the show, Melanie.
Thank you, Abel. I am so excited to be here. I'm really, really looking forward to this. I've been following your work for so long, and it was such a pleasure when I interviewed you. So everything full circle.
That was so much fun. But I was wondering, how did and this is using your terminology here, a Disney-loving blonde actress from Tennessee get into all of this biohacking and kind of cutting-edge stuff?
I ask myself this question like every single day. I'm like, how did I end up here? Like, what is happening? What is my life? Honestly, it started kind of similar to things you've talked about, having my own personal health challenges and just searching relentlessly for answers. And what I found was that when things actually worked, I would get so excited that I wanted to just like share it with everybody and learn even more. Right. So I can relate with the show. Yeah. So it's basically, I'm just like, I'm a teller. I'm a learner and a teller and a sharer. So I find things that work and I just have to like tell everybody.
Right. And part of your story was, you know, and many people might not realize this, but putting on weight kind of early with birth control and Accutane and all sorts of like traditional Western medicine interventions in that are really coming earlier and earlier in people's lives.
Yeah, 100%. And I get that question a lot. Like, was I ever, you know, really overweight or anything? And I was never like obese or super overweight, but I definitely, like you mentioned it, I went on, looking back, I just think it's a little bit, it's really sad that like things like you would be put on birth control in high school for acne when I think
right.
Like if I knew now, like what I knew then, I feel like there are so many things I could have done instead. Right. But yeah, just like weight fluctuations and all of that and crazy dieting. And again, finally finding things that would work, led to me wanting to just tell everybody about it, like intermittent fasting and paleo and all of that.
But you went through some wackier diets before that, huh?
I did. I tried everything in college. I did the cookie diet, which was really interesting. They would like send you like I feel so bad for my roommates. I was like always doing something crazy. And I remember with the cookie diet, they would like send these massive shipments of cookies.
I bet they weren't cheap.
No, they were not cheap. And also I've recently looked back at the ingredients and I think like gluten is like the first ingredient on the list. Yeah. So we do not do that anymore.
So what was it that resonated for you first? Was it the food or the intermittent fasting or some combination?
Yeah. So I was trying all these crazy diets and then I read Atkins. I feel like so many people started with low carb and I was just fascinated because that was the first diet where not only was it actually working, but ketones. And so I was like, wow, I can scientifically measure my fat burning. This is incredible. I have to learn more. And then not only was it actually effective, but I started experiencing all of these other health benefits. So like my mood and my energy and my skin. And so that like opened the rabbit hole. And this was about like a decade ago. And I remember I read a blog post about people doing one meal a day intermittent fasting because like nobody was talking about intermittent fasting. And I was like, I'm going to try this for a week. And then I never stopped that either.
Yeah. So. I hear you. I've been doing it for about the same timeline. And I remember then there was kind of a swelling or a wave of attention around then. And Ori Hofmeckler, The Warrior Diet, is a total classic and way underrated by a lot of people. I had the fortune to interview him many years back, but super sharp guy. But even he, of course, wasn't the first guy to think of that. And he was, that's what the book says. He's borrowing from tradition. There's been a long tradition and history of intermittent fasting and different ways to have that manifest in your own life. So what does that look like for you? And have you adapted much over the years in your approach?
Yeah. And so The Warrior Diet, that was after I read that blog post, that's when I read The Warrior Diet and I interviewed Ori too.
Isn't he awesome?
He's amazing. Like his personality and his energy is just like, he reminds me of like Wim Hof. Like they have the similar like personality. So as far as like how it's adapted, cause it's funny, people ask me that a lot as well, because you know, there's so many ways that you can do fasting. How do you do the intermittent fasting?
I started with something like 16-8, but moved pretty quickly to more like a one meal a day, but it's more like a 1.5 meal a day where I have a couple hours. I break my fast with like a broth or like something like a fat MIT or whatever it is, that kind of pre-eating stage, which I think is, I don't know, it's more of a spectrum of eating, and then there's the strict fasting, right? And then there's the kind of like you eat fat and you consume calories or protein and stuff, but it's also fasting. And I think we sometimes get carried away with the terminology. But strictly speaking, I don't have calories before like noon most days. And so that is kind of like the more strict 16-8 type fast.
Okay. I love it. I love it. Yeah. Yeah. And it's so true. There's like semantics and so many different ways to approach it. And it can get heated. Like people can get really like emotional and I'm just like, it's okay. Like everything is okay. I feel like, especially in the dietary world, things very quickly get opinionated and like wars. But as far as me, I'm very extreme. So one meal a day is how I first started it. And I eat really late. Like, I'm a late person. I've been studying chronotypes recently, and yeah, I'm a late night person. So
I was going to ask you about that. We can do that next. But kind of early bird versus night person.
Yes. So in college, it hasn't really changed. I would start eating around like 10 PM and that's still sort of what I do, or 9. And in college they would mark down the rotisserie chickens every night at like 10 or 11 PM at the Kroger Ralph's right by me. So I would wait, and they'd be like $3, and then I would get a rotisserie chicken and I would just eat that. I did that for like 6 months. This is pre-carnivore too. Like pre-carnivore movement as a thing. And so to this day though, I still do really late night, one meal a day. What I'm eating is pretty different, but even that is pretty consistent now. So yes, late night feaster.
How close to bedtime or what? So you said you start eating around 10?
Yep, usually like 9:30, 10. And I pretty much eat right until I go to bed. And I know you're not supposed to do that, but when I don't know.
No, okay.
It's working.
I'm guilty of this sometimes too, but the reason is a lot of times I fall asleep early when the sun goes down. I'm kind of like aligned with that schedule. So I'll go to sleep at like 8:30 or 9 o'clock. Sometimes I'll be out. But you know, if I don't start eating like solid foods until 5 or 6, which is pretty common for me, I'm still eating until like 8. And for the most part, I haven't seen major problems from that. I think metabolically speaking, there could be a better way to do it, but eating around the sun works for me. But that brings me to my next thing, because when I was doing a lot of performing, playing lots of music shows, like 200 or 300 a year for a while, I was definitely more of a night person. But the longer I've kind of lived this way, I wake up at like 4:30 in the morning, sometimes 5:30 in the morning, almost every day. I wake up and I practice piano and play guitar or whatever, but I'm definitely like a morning person now, however that happened. So have you always been a night person? What does that look like?
Yeah. Well, first of all, I'm so jealous of you and your mornings. Like, I want to be a morning person. Like, if I could change, I'm so happy with my life. I'm so grateful. I love everything. If I could change one thing, two things, it'd be my digestive like issues that I go through. And then I just want to be a morning person. But I've always been a late night person. And I do think, because we also get a lot of questions on my intermittent fasting podcast about like the metabolic benefits of early versus late night eating. And I, like my co-host thinks there's not really enough research on it. I do think that the research pretty supports that early eating is better, but I also think that what makes you happy and what you can stick to is much more sustainable. Kind of like with exercise, it's like the exercise that you do. So I still do the late night. But yeah, no, I've always been a late night person, and I'm currently reading The Power of When, Dr. Michael Bruce. He's a sleep expert, because I'm going to interview him, and he has like 4 chronotypes in his book. And I keep taking the quiz, and I'm the, like the insomniac dolphin. So it's fine.
What really aligns with, at least one of your careers, which is performing, where I don't know about you, but if I were on camera all day, or if I were waiting to do a show or doing music shows throughout the day, I kind of just wouldn't eat for most of the day and wouldn't be hungry. And if I did eat, it would be just good. I don't know. I was too hyped up for that to feel right. And then, you know, once all the shows were done, you're just absolutely famished and you eat everything in sight and then you fall asleep, right? That's kind of the typical. I wasn't unusual in my approach, right? That's pretty typical.
No, like literally exact same. And especially when I was in LA, and like when I first graduated, I did like 6 months or so of just doing background on like every television show known to mankind. And that's when that lifestyle really fit really well, because basically you're just sitting around and there's lots of food. And I just like didn't want to deal with it. And like when I would eat, it would just like mess with my energy. But the reason I actually wrote my book at the very beginning was because I was like meeting people, new people every single day on different sets and getting asked the same questions every single day about like, why am I not eating? So I was like, I just need to write a book. And I can just be like, here, this is why. You can read this.
You did. And yes. I heard it. More than a few people read it. It's a great book, but
thank you.
Check it out. Well, and one of the main themes of that book is you seem to have quite a bit of fun. And a lot of the diet books out there, a lot of the different approaches to health can be pretty bland, pretty boring, and pretty just like cut and dry, same thing every day, no coloring outside the lines, this is how I live type deal. And I'm sure you encounter a lot of that, you know, working as an actress as well. So I'm curious about like how your approach differs from that other more common approach.
Yeah. Well, first of all, it's really similar to your book as well. I got that vibe too, you know, like, cause like food is meant to be enjoyed and you don't have to be restrictive and all crazy all the time. And, so yeah, that really resonated. And that's when I like with what, when, why, and I tried to make, cause I wrote it when paleo was more, I feel like paleo is on the downtrend with like the name, but, it's when people were talking about it more. And, I try to make, cause I am like, I'm not black and white when it comes to food. Like, I think there's no one right food for everybody. There's no one right diet. I think it's like, kind of like you used the word spectrum earlier. It's like a spectrum of food and there's shades of food and people are individual and unique. And so I tried to make it where, I mean, I had like yes, no, and maybe foods, but the no foods were things that I don't really quite consider food, like processed foods or things that we would not like as a species have been eating, like gluten and a lot of grains and processed seed oils. And then there's like the maybe foods, like foods that people may or may not work for you. So things like dairy. And then like the yes foods were, you know, basically like whole foods. So meat, fruit, vegetables, seafood. So I really want people to feel very free. Like food should not be scary. And it shouldn't be, in my opinion, a morality thing. It should just be what works for you.
Now, why do you want to be a morning person though?
Because I feel like so many reasons. I feel like the a lot of the messaging out there is that like morning people, I don't know, like they tackle the world
and they get all the praise these days, which is one of the reasons I ask, because it's not necessarily better. It's better in certain ways.
Yeah. I guess I'm being sucked into the messaging and then
sucked into the brainwashing by the morning people.
I think also like on the rare occasion that I have had to get up early for something and I have forced myself into it, I have like this moment where I'm like, oh, I could wake up more, like every day early and like tackle the day. And when that happens, I get so much done by the time that I'd normally be waking up. I'm like, wow. And then, and then I still end up staying up late. So the day just becomes this like massive day of productivity and epicness. But I'm not.
Well, that's cool. And that's certainly fine with me. And I think you can go through different stages and it's perfectly appropriate to do so. On vacation, I can kind of go back and forth between the night person or I can get onto that mode again. And it's just like switching a time zone or something. You can go into that mode for a while and you can shift back. But, you know, for most people, it doesn't work out that well. One of the reasons I don't really play live shows anymore is because playing late at night. I remember I used to go on stage sometimes at 12, it'd be like 12:30 a.m. time to go on stage. And then you're out until 3 and then packing up until 3:30 and driving home and it's 4, you know, the sun starts coming up and it's a weird deal to try to get all your ducks in a row if that's the reality of your lifestyle.
No, I'm so glad you said that because everything that I said probably makes it sound like, yeah, I'd love to like play a show if I was playing shows at midnight, but no, like I have to have my very intense like wind down routine and I turn off, like once I go into like food and like mode, I read books, I turn off social media, like I need my sacred like wind down sleep time. So yeah, that as well would not be I would not want the like the bulk of my actual work to be late.
Right.
Would not do well.
So what does the meal actually look like once you get around to it?
Also, people ask me this all the time because they want to eat what I'm eating. And I'm like, no. Like, I'm like, you eat what you eat. And
we'll get a cheap rotisserie chicken.
I know. I'm past those days. Thank goodness. But what I'm eating, or like I'll work with brands and they'll be like, can you like take photos of your food? I'm like, nobody wants to see my food. Like, it's not exciting. Like, it's not elaborate. I literally just eat like pounds. And I mean pounds of, okay. So here's my thing. I either do high carb, low fat, or low carb, high fat. Because I find that for me personally, I don't, my body does not process like carbs and fat together well. So I address that by doing one or the other, each night. And so depending on what it is, the staple is protein. So there's always like pounds, and I mean pounds of lean, like animal protein or fish, lots of cucumbers for always. And then I either do like pounds of fruit or I add fat.
You just said pounds of fruit, right?
Mm-hmm.
What kinds of fruit are we talking about?
Pretty much like pounds and pounds of blueberries or pounds and pounds of pineapple, which helps digest all the meat. It really is pounds. Like if you look at those frozen, those big bags at like Whole Foods, a frozen fruit. I mean, those are a couple pounds and I eat a couple bags.
That's amazing. And what do your, you know, actress and actor friends think about all this?
I think people are just pretty fascinated. I mean, people want to know a lot what I eat.
I think a bunch of them are coming on board or did years ago at this point, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. So, and especially because people will often ask like if they feel like they've hit weight loss plateaus or that they are not losing weight. I just mentioned like those two dichotomies, but I really think there's a metabolic magic to low carb, high fat or high fat, low carb. But I think the key is that they really have to actually be low. Like most people don't actually make them low enough. So like if it's low fat, I think this is for like weight loss. If it's low fat, like make it low fat. If it's low carb, make it low carb. Cause if you like get in this nebulous like waters where you have just a little bit of the, too much of the other macro, it can like throw things off. And I've done a lot of research on this.
Yeah. And well, even just looking at general calorie restriction that slogs on day after day, you can mess up your metabolism in a lot of different ways doing that. But if you're more nuanced and strategic and start to get into, you know, the way that your body works and reacts to all these different inputs and outputs, you can really dial it in. And you did try calorie restriction for a long time without success, right? Before all this.
Yeah, 100%. And I think that's the, like, now I never count calories and I don't really advocate it because you just don't need to. Like you can do all of these, like with intermittent fasting and whole foods and playing with the macros, which with the macros, I don't even count it. I just choose those foods that create that. And there's so much more, at least in my opinion, metabolic magic to the types of foods that you're eating rather than this whole concept of calories, which is just not accurate. we all process calories so differently. And, you know, any given person can take in a certain food and their body can use it. Their body could extract a completely different number of calories from it than another person's body, based on so many factors. So, and they could compensate and their body could upregulate their, you know, their non-activity, their non-exercise, their NEAT, their non-exercise activity thermogenesis to like compensate. And we just can't control it by a label, a calorie label.
So the low fat versus low carb, how do you switch back and forth and how quickly is it? Like Tuesday night, you're eating 2 pounds of blueberries and Wednesday night, you're eating like a whole rotisserie chicken or is it?
Oh my gosh. It's usually just whatever I'm feeling. And I tend to get in runs of it. So like I've been doing just the fruit, the lower fat version, for quite a while. And sometimes like I will have like I don't ever add fat when I'm eating all of that fruit, but I might do like salmon, which can be like pretty higher, you know, higher fat, or like beef or steak. So I'm still getting like fat nutrients. This is not like crazy, like, I don't know. Cause when you hear low fat, especially in like the carnivore, keto, paleo world, people can get, I think, a little bit scared. But it's not like that. I just make sure that I'm not in the same, since I'm only doing one meal a day, I don't in the same meal combine the things.
Yeah, that makes sense. And I would assume that looking back seasonally, the source of our calories would have largely shifted from day to day, or certainly from season to season, eating plentiful amounts of fruit sometimes, but not all the time.
Yes, exactly. And like when you're eating the fruits, it would be the time that they're probably not hunting as much, so there's not as much of the fatty. And then when it's like hunting in the winter and there's less fruits, because in nature, fat and carbs are really just found together in nuts, which are during autumn, and when you're like stocking up for the winter, or dairy, which is pretty much a food made to grow you. So I don't think there's much, I don't think there's a huge case for like ample sources of high fat, high carb foods just walking around or living or existing in nature.
So basically you'll just go on this kick of eating low fat for a while and then low carb other times. Have you seen it align with the seasons? Like, do you have different cravings if it's cold? I guess it depends on your climate or whatever, or how much you're traveling, but I'm curious if you've seen a link there.
100%. Like during the summer, I don't really want to do the low carb, high fat.
Right. Same here.
It's hot.
Yeah. It's hot. Like plowing through watermelons and pouring salt on the top and stuff.
Yeah, 100%. And actually, so especially when I do the low carb, high fat, I often, this is another hack that I feel like more people will be talking about this, but they're not. Cause a lot of people do low carb, high fat for weight loss and will go really high on the fat. One, I think people think that like eating more and more fat is the way to lose fat if you're low carb, high fat. And I don't necessarily think that's the case. Like, those calories don't like magically, just disappear. Like they're not like free. they're still eating them. But if you replace all of the fats with MCT oil, specifically C8, the, caprylic acid, I've done a lot of research. I don't think that fat can actually be stored as fat. Like there's not really like a pathway for it to be stored as fat. It's pretty much just burned in the liver as energy and it like ramps up your metabolism. So if you do like low carb, high fat and just do massive amounts of C8 as here, if you can tolerate it digestively.
I can.
Okay. You said you can't.
No, yeah. I had a bottleneck and I found it pretty quick.
Okay. Well, for helps me a lot because I tend to be slower in the digestive department. So it keeps things moving. But I've been shocked by the weight loss effects of it. I actually started it because it's when I was actually trying to gain weight. And I was like, what fat is like not gonna be like really sluggish and be like easily assimilated? And I was like, I'll just do like gobs and gobs of MCT oil. And I literally started adding, I'm not making this up, probably like 2,000 or 3,000 extra calories a day to gain weight. And instead I lost weight. And then since then, so I've seen this, there's this girl on Instagram who's done the same experiment and it's a thing.
Well, so. You know, I can think of when we've gone to like tropical climates for a few weeks on vacation, our you know, especially coming from the mountains or somewhere cold, our cravings completely change. And it seems like we can get away with almost outrageous amounts of coconut fat, coconut oil, and just drinking coconuts all day, the juice, and eating enormous amounts of fruits and nuts. And really, like you said, also not craving those heavy meats. Like we definitely do in the winter.
Yeah, no, 100%. And I will make a clarification for listeners, because if they like the C8 version is it's a very like fractionated, I don't know if it's fractionated. It's only one of the fatty acids from coconut oil. So coconut oil will also have a similar effect. Actually, when I was eating the rotisserie chickens in college, I would slather it in coconut oil.
Great tip to make chicken fish taste better, for sure.
It tasted so good. But the C8 is like the most least likely to be stored as body fat. So,
because something else might happen.
Yes.
Or your body does burn it really, really well. But yeah, it seems to me that in general, I do better, and my wife as well, with coconut oil. And it's hard to like overdo it with coconut oil in the same way, where it's just like, I can do fine with maybe 1 to 2 tablespoons of the MCTs and the C8, but anything, any little bit more than that, and all of a sudden I'm in trouble. So everyone's a little bit different, and we all have to figure out what our tolerance is for different foods. And wearing CGMs, once you start tracking things and all of this, you find that like eating a banana or a cookie for one person is completely different in terms of the effect it has on their blood sugar and insulin and all the rest of that, as to someone else. Or even the same person on a different day will have a different response to the same foods. And so it's really fascinating once you get in there. So how have you been tracking recently? I know that you're into a few different devices, and what are some of the biohacks that have your attention recently?
Yes, I love. Well, have you done the CGMs?
Yeah, a few times, and it always has some surprises in there.
They're so addicting. I went through, when I first found them, I went through like my CGM addiction period, and I think I wore one for like a few months. I need to put another one on. So CGMs, I really, really recommend. And I just realized I took it off my Oura Ring, which I am obsessed with. The thing I love about Oura Ring, I think my favorite thing about Oura Ring is it took me so long to get one because I thought it was going to tell me, because I knew it would not be happy with how late I go to bed. And I was like, I don't want to get it because it's going to like tell me to go to bed early. And I thought that, you know, what if I don't sleep well and then I wake up and it's like, oh, you slept awful. But it's not like that. Like my Oura Ring tells me to go to bed at like 1:30 a.m. like between 1:30 and 2:30. Sometimes it's trying to make me go to bed early, and sometimes it's like go to bed at 12:30 a.m. and then I know it's like trying to make me go to bed early. But I'm shocked that it really adjusts to the individual, and also that I had the founder Harpreet on my show twice, and I was just telling him how I love that it talks to you like very nicely. Like it never makes you feel like you did something, like you slept awful or terrible. It's like very nice and like how it talks to you. Do you have one?
Yeah, I've been using it for a while. I've been in touch with Harpreet, and it's funny because I had almost the opposite experience, especially being a morning person. I'm a light sleeper, that's for sure. And I do wake up over the course of the night, or I toss and turn. And like usually it wakes up and it's just like, nice try last night. I'm feeling great. I thought I had slept well. I've been in bed for 8+ hours, and it's just like, nice try. You got 3.5 hours of sleep for something like crazy. Sometimes, not every time, but sometimes that happens. And I'm curious, you know, how that kind of stacks up against the early bird person, the night people. And also to me, it's been interesting, you know, being in close proximity to my wife and not many other people over the past year and a half, and just like seeing our sleeping patterns. And it seems like to me, I can get away with 1 or 2 fewer hours of sleep on my own volition, like just waking up without an alarm, and she'll wake up 1 hour or 2 later, just on a regular basis. We're built a little bit differently. It seems like our bodies have different needs. But when you start looking at the different trackers, I can 100% say that the Oura Ring and a number of other ones, like a Garmin watch and a few others, have been really useful for moderating my behavior, making sure I don't drink too much. Like, man, does the ring show when you've overdone it, doesn't it? For me, it's like my resting heart rate is like 10, 15 beats above normal. It's like, man, you really hit it hard last night, huh?
No, that's when I knew. Cause I remember I was really, because like I said, I identify as an insomniac. Although I feel like all the quote biohacking things I've done for sleep have, like, I'm pretty good now with sleep, like with everything that I do. But when I first got Oura Ring, I was shocked. I was like, it says that I'm sleeping pretty well. Like, I was like, I'm doing really well. And I was like, maybe it's not accurate. And then I had my first night since having the Oura Ring when I drank a lot. And I woke up and I was like, oh, it knows.
It knows.
Like, it knows. So, yeah, I think there's so much value there. I actually haven't used Garmin, or you said Garmin was the other one that you have?
Yeah, that's for like a GPS, like mountain watch that has altitude and pressure and all these other things. But it's amazing the amount of technology you can throw on your wrist. I did not like the Apple watches at all. Like, zero did I like them, because they were way too dainty. And I just like, when I go outside, I like not having to worry about something fancy like on my hands or wrist to get beaten around. And this ring has put up with a ton. Like, I've been wearing it for over 2 years. It's put up with a lot of abuse, heavy lifts, deadlifts, you know, like climbing on rocks, all sorts of things. And so it's great to find those pieces of gear that work with you, who you are and what your lifestyle is. I haven't tried the Whoops strap, but I've heard a lot of people rave about that too.
Yeah, I've only really with wearables with like this tried Aura, and I feel really naked because I took it off right before this. I'm so impressed that you had it for 2 years, because I lost mine 3 times. And
interesting.
Yeah, it so the first one fell off. Like, I know where it fell off because I fell. And I didn't realize that it fell off in that moment. And it was like when I was traveling. So it was like, I couldn't go get it. Second time. No, actually, no, I guess I just lost it twice. Three rings, lost it twice. The second one, I'm so sad. I like bought the diamond one, like all by myself, like, and I lost it. And I have no idea. Like, I went for listeners who have an Aura ring, I didn't know this. You can download a Bluetooth tracking app, and it will show you, and it's shocking, it will show you like all of the Bluetooth devices around you and how far away they are. It's really scary, like how many things like in the world are out there.
Well, let's talk about being on camera in general, because it's something that many people are new to, but now having been on, you know, hundreds of Zoom classroom meetings or meetings with other people, all this stuff, what are some of your like tips for being on camera, coming off as like the real person who you are, not trying to be too phony or artificial? And also then, you know, maybe a follow-up, how do you act?
Oh my goodness. It's so ironic that I somehow ended up as like an influencer, or like all the selfies and like on camera and all. So acting I love, but when you're acting, it's not you, and you're not thinking about the camera. So like, it's like a completely different mindset. I actually don't like being on camera when it's like, like if I can like see myself or like selfies or video, I actually very much do not like it.
I actually hate it. I hate that.
I actually do too. So, that's actually when I started my second show, the Melanie Avalon Biohacking Podcast, the one that you were on. I was like, the only way I can do this show, because my other show is just me and my co-host talking, so I'm like very used to it. But that one, I was like, the only way I can do this show is if it's not video, because I will just be like so stressed about it every single time that I'm just gonna have to do audio only so I can like focus. So that was not helpful, because you're asking for for helpful things.
Helpful. No, that is helpful, because I think people assume that once we had Dick Tracy watches with, you know, people's faces on them and you could talk, and then phones, you know, like straight out of sci-fi movies where you can have people's faces on looking at your face, you'd assume that that would be better and that people would communicate better and it would be a better experience. I dislike being on camera. Any chance I can to just have an audio call versus a video one, way better for me. I really appreciate that when it happens. And so I think that's important for people out there, because now there is this expectation that everything's on Zoom, but being on camera extracts a toll. At least for me, you do have to hype up the energy. And if you do it for too long, you need to crash and then just not be in front of any camera or any eyes for a while. At least that's how I feel. And it sounds to me like you're kind of similar in that sense.
Yeah, no, this conversation is making me so happy. Literally exactly how I feel. And especially like on some of the interviews I do where it's like very, very intense. And like, I have like 20 pages of notes and it's like all this really intense science. Like the last thing I want to be thinking about is, cause I don't know. I think like about like how I'm like how I look and all of this. And it's just like unnecessary distraction. And, actually with the Zoom calls, because I do so many Zoom calls every week with different brands and companies. And I just, I used to like feel bad about this, but now I'm just like, I just need to do it for mental health. I just tell them to call me. So like when they send me like the Zoom link, I'm like, oh, can you just actually call me at this number?
That's a great strategy. I think because people's expectations, it's not like they actually, this is what I realized too. It's like they send you a Zoom call and it's like, that's not what they actually want. It's just the default. It's what everyone does these days. But yeah, being able to look at your notes, take notes, mostly just feel like the entire world isn't looking at you forever, which is the feeling that we all get in front of cameras and, you know, in a surveillance state and all this other dystopian stuff. When you turn the cameras off and you're just talking to each other again, like the old fashioned way, you can actually have a lot of fun, talk for hours and things like that. But being on camera in front of a screen for hours, totally different deal and definitely not better. Definitely not better for everyone.
100%. And you nailed it with, I think people send the Zoom links, like we would think, oh, it's because they want to have a Zoom, but it's just because that's like the protocol. So yeah. You can just say, here's my number. Yeah. Call me.
They might love it. Most people I love that, right?
Yeah. So it works really well. And and like something about the screens, I could talk, you know, on a stage in front of like thousands of people and like it wouldn't bother me. And I can talk on the phone with somebody for hours. It doesn't bother me. It's just like having your face in your face. And I also heard that there is something about the 2D medium that does, I don't know the specifics, but it's something about like our psyche and our brain and how it processes what we're seeing and not actually seeing the full 3D real life thing does something with our psyche.
It kind of like watching TV versus reading a book, right? Or listening to an audiobook, where you have to use your imagination and it's on you to do that work creatively. If you're using those lower tech without video input, but it's like me looking at you now, you're the size of Tinkerbell and it's like I have the blue light pulled out of the screen so it doesn't tax me too much over the course of a long day doing interviews. And this is, you know, a far cry from actually hanging out in the same room together. Is it better to have like the visual cues when you're talking to each other? I think for interviews, maybe so sometimes, but is it worth being on camera all day? I ask myself that question. I really do. And if I didn't have that momentum in our own kind of like channels of putting things out there with video all the time, I got started doing audio podcasting and much prefer that that platform to create and to listen to other people, because oftentimes you don't need to look at people's faces all the time to listen to their research or their position or their philosophy on anything.
Yeah, and in a way it I don't know, it really forces you because you have to listen, like there's nothing else you can like look for or go off of. But I don't know, I'm just so happy to talk to you about this because like it's such a thing for me. And I felt so bad for so long with the other show, like just doing audio. But I'm going to keep it audio as long as I can.
But what's fascinating about that is that you see the acting on camera as a different deal. Is that because your brain is in a different state and you feel like you're really in that state of play where you can't even be self-conscious anymore, or what is it?
Yeah. Cause with the acting, it's not about presenting me to the camera and the focus on the camera. It's about whatever the character and scene is. So it's like, I'm not even there in a way. It's more similar to theater in that perspective. I think it's really interesting because like I said, people often assume since I'm an actress and since I do all the influencing stuff that the camera would just be like the best for me.
You're a typical example of more the introverted actress type that is more common than people realize, or are there a lot of just kind of attention seekers, or just a nice blend?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And I've thought about it as well, because I know like my sister, for example, is like the polar opposite of me. Like she's just like so confident and extrovert and like selfie queen. And I am very much jealous of her. But I definitely think that there's a, spectrum. I would identify as like very introverted. Do you consider yourself introverted?
Yeah. The older I get, the more introverted I get.
Yeah. So I'm the type of person that like, I do love going out and like meeting people and stuff, but that's like it's very fun and exciting, but it's very draining to me. Like when I'm done, I'm like exhausted and like, I can't do that every single night. So I'm in awe of people that, it's the opposite. Like they get energy from going out. But I definitely do think it's a spectrum. I really recommend, do you know John Levy?
Have you met him? Yeah, a little bit.
I just read his book, You're Invited, which is all about like forming connections and influencer stuff and all of that. But he talks about introversion and extroversion. And I had him on the show and I asked him that question that you just asked me, like, are people introverts or extroverts? And he was saying that, because he's a behavioral scientist or the type of person that studies behavior. And he said, it's definitely like a spectrum. Like it's not on or off. I don't know what most people are though. I feel like most influencers probably are not like me, like influencers, but I don't know.
But you're not really an influencer. You come at this from a different direction as do I. Like I came at this from really the music writing and performance and recording world more than, you know, if you're an influencer in the past and not to knock anybody, but in the last, you know, 2 to 5 years, who made it on Instagram or TikTok or something like that. It's kind of a different deal than like long form audio only conversations, right? It's a different media. It's a different form. And I think it's a shame that influencer is this term that's thrown around. It's derogatory in a lot of ways. It's problematic, but more than anything, it describes all of these things as kind of the same thing. Whereas, I don't know. The influencers or whatever who I've met, a lot of them really are quite introverted, because what people don't realize is how much behind the scenes work it takes to make all this stuff happen online and to get all of this content out. Like, I don't know what the ratio is, but generally speaking, it's many multiples of time prepping for, you know, for me, reading stacks of books or just like going deep into people's work beforehand, all by myself, hours and hours and hours. Being a musician, practicing hours and hours and hours, just like in a tiny room that's not ventilated with no windows, just practicing and practicing, you know. And same thing with developing any craft, like learning how to act and all that. Obviously, it's more collaborative in some ways, but kind of a lonely adventure.
I can't believe you said that. Literally, I was thinking about all of this today, because there's one brand that I work with, and it's a CBD company, and I love their products so much. And so I do a lot of work with them. And they've done like whitelisted Facebook ads through my account. And I realized I hadn't been signing into my like business Facebook before. And so I did, and there was like all these notifications, and I found all of these comments on those ads from people. And so many comments about like, oh, like, why are we going to listen to this, you know, influencer, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, I'm a real person. like, and I love this CBD and like, I love this company.